Welcome to the Pint Size Personalization Podcast, brought to you by Johnson Plastics Plus. In this podcast, we talk to the movers and shakers, the influencers and makers who bring personalization to life. We find out what makes them tick and how they became successful in what they do. Today, Jackie's talking with Michael Mullins from Laser Engraving 911. Jackie, take it away.
Hi, everybody. I am here with Michael from Laser Engraving 911, and we are super excited to talk about the laser engraving business, how Michael got his start in this industry, and some advice and tips and tricks that Laser Engraving 911 has for our listeners. So let's just go ahead and jump in. Can you tell us, first of all, a little bit about you and what inspired you to start your own business? How did you get into this crazy world of laser engraving?
Well, I can kind of summarize that, but first I want to say thank you for having me on and thank you for taking the time to set this up. I always enjoy sharing my origin stories, and I think that in hopes that it can help other people in their journey. So you asked me how I got started. So, and I get asked this question a lot by customers here in my shop all the time, because they come into the shop and they see all this crazy laser equipment and all these workbenches, and they're like, how did you get into this? Because it's just, it's kind of an odd, it's not so odd now to have a home laser engraving business, but I think to them, it just seems kind of mind-blowing that they don't understand. So I got started by accident. I actually had back in, 10 years ago, I had a different business that had nothing to do with laser engraving, and I was located in California. I actually had an e-cigarette retail shop, and I didn't just have one. I had three of them. I had three physical locations and an online store, and the business was very, very good. And I thought it would be a great idea to be able to customize people's products in the store with a laser, like as an add-on service. And so I bought this really, really expensive fiber laser, because that's the type of laser I needed. And I put it in the shop. I put up advertisements in the store. Hey, get your e-cigarette engraved before you leave the shop with your name on it or a logo. And I was so excited, and I thought that people would just love this idea. And nobody was interested in having it done. I couldn't give the service away for free. And so I learned a very valuable lesson that I learned a $38,000 lesson immediately.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
I learned that people only want to have things engraved that have intrinsic value to them. So, or that have more meaning. They don't want to get things engraved that are not meaningful, or something that can become meaningful by having it engraved. So paying that extra $25 or $30 to do a custom engraving on something that's just going to be either swapped out for the next new model in 2 months, or whatever, is not something that, so it was like, I made a calculated error there. So I'm looking at this really expensive fiber laser, because you have to understand, 10 years ago, there weren't $4,000 fiber lasers. Like you see, it was not readily available. So I was staring at this machine in my warehouse going, uh-oh. And I didn't finance it. I paid cash. So it was like mine. So I said, I need to figure out what industries can benefit from this machine, because this machine can do a lot of cool stuff. So I started hitting the street. I went to the knife stores. I went to the machine shops. I went to the jewelry stores. I went to the watch stores. I went everywhere I thought someone could benefit from fiber laser engraving. And lo and behold, I was the only person within miles and miles and miles that could offer this type of engraving. And they all were like, yes, we love what you can do with that machine. Here's some work. And that's how great. Sonoma Laser Engraving was born.
So I really, that's an awesome story. And I think the great thing about that is, you know, understanding, and it sounds to me like, you know, you start one thing and you were just talking to the wrong people. And it sounded like you were like, you know, you could have gotten really discouraged and said, I made a mistake. Oh no. But what you did was take that, you know, $38,000 laser and say, okay, I have this and somebody needs it. I just need to find who those people are.
Yes, that's right. So, I did find those people. And as the business was born, I learned as I, you know, obviously before I started working on all these people's items, I did a lot of playing around first. So I would go to Goodwill and buy all kinds of different metal things. And I would just either do really good on them or destroy them, but it was my stuff, not their stuff. And
right,
I probably
right.
spent three or four months just getting used to engraving metal of all kinds and some polymers with the fiber laser and recording all my settings. And then finally, when I was like kind of ready to felt confident, I started working on other people's stuff and it was a hit.
So tell us now, are you, have you expanded into different types of lasers since that?
Yes, that's
fiber laser. Tell us a little bit about that and how you make your decisions now about making a purchase like that, and you know what you like about the fiber laser versus other tools that you're using, and how that all kind of unfolded.
Yeah, so what happened was very quickly once I opened up Sonoma Laser Engraving and we started with a fiber laser, I started getting calls for all the other materials because we were just listed as a business. I got a business license. I got a resale certificate. I made a Google listing, business listing. I did everything that you need to do to open up a business. So I was out there with a website. And so now there are people who are calling for cutting boards, acrylic, leather, all the things that fiber lasers were never designed to do in the first place. Right? Tumblers, right? I see a lot of people using fiber lasers to do tumblers. And it can be done, but they're really not designed to do large volume tumblers. You need a CO2 laser and a rotary tool to get that kind of volume done. So I immediately said, I need to buy a CO2 laser because I'm missing out on business, tons and tons of business every month that I can't do with this fiber laser. So that forced me to invest in a CO2 laser. And I didn't know anything about CO2 lasers. I didn't know about speeds. I didn't know. All I knew is that a CO2 laser could engrave everything I wanted that I couldn't do with the fiber. And I knew I needed a rotary tool to do cups and cylindrical objects. And I did research. But I also was very new and I didn't understand that there's slow laser, CO2 lasers, and that there's fast lasers. And so I bought a very large, powerful, hear me out. I bought a very, I won't say their name because I had a bad experience with it, but I bought a very large, overpowered, slow as heck laser. Okay. And that's what, if there's anything that people could take away from my mistake here is that right now on the market today, you're going to see huge bed CO2 lasers with 150, 120 watts. But what you missed was that they're super, super slow. And if you're going to do large production or anything like that or do large volume, it's the large bed size and the power is not going to help you if you have a slow laser.
Yeah, that's a great, I think that's a really, you know, good point to consider is, you know, understanding what your goal is for your machine, because for somebody, and it's just like the fiber laser, you know, for somebody that was the perfect investment and it became the perfect investment for you, but understanding what you need from your equipment and what you want to do is, I think, key to making those purchasing decisions. You know, especially as a small business, like you said, you didn't finance that first machine. Like, you know, money's not growing on trees. So it's important to be careful with how you spend your money, which kind of takes me to my next question is, what factors do you consider when you're selecting a vendor for purchasing your equipment or purchasing your substrates? What things should people look for, you know, when they're carefully making those decisions for their business?
Absolutely. I learned very quickly that why I had bought this really big machine, that I was taking a long time to complete jobs, which was eating into my bottom end, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I was also having a lot of problems with the machine. It was messing up jobs, which is really scary. Not of no fault of mine. So I learned a lesson that to complete more jobs in a day, you have to have something that works faster, right? I ended up sending that machine back and buying an Epilogue within my first year. And I still have that Epilogue today, and it was the best decision I ever made. And I did finance that because it's even more than CyberLaser. I did finance that, but that machine paid itself off in, I think, about 2.5 years. It was amazing.
That's awesome.
And that was with a lot of hard work, but it can really churn out jobs fast. And so I went with Epilogue, and I go with vendors like Johnson Plastic Plus, and because of mostly their, what I look at is the quality of the product, mm-hmm. the customer support, and the track record behind the product, whether it's Romark, whether it's Blanks, whether it's, you know, whatever. And I look, obviously I do research, like how many people are using this company? You know, is this mm-hmm. a popular company? What is their track record like? So with Epilogue, I found that they had a very excellent track record of help working with their customers. And when I found Johnson, I didn't find Johnson Plastic Plus until I had a CO2 laser, because I was just working on metal stuff. And I wasn't really offering, at that point, I wasn't offering customized products. I was just doing work on other people's products. So as soon as I got the CO2 laser, I said, oh, now I can start putting things online that are blank that I can customize. Where do I find those? And initially I started looking overseas at like Alibaba to buy in bulk, but I found that to be, while that is still an option that I do use for some products, but not very often, I found that I was much more comfortable buying from someone within the States, someone I could pick up the phone and call if I had a problem or ask a question about the product. That was huge to me. Like, I would gladly pay more for wholesale bulk laser engraving items with a company that has great customer support, that has a real person that I can call and say, I'm having an issue with this, or I got the wrong part. That happened to me recently, actually. I got some Romark stuff, and I think it was someone else's order. And it was huge sheets of Romark, like the biggest sheets I've ever seen in my entire life. It was a huge box. And I just was ordering my little 12x24. And it was from JPP, and I called right away and I said, I think you sent me the wrong stuff. This is what I got. I took pictures of it, and they're like, don't worry about it. We're so sorry. No big deal. We see your order now. Just keep it. And I was like, so the cool thing about it was that it's actually material that I use a lot. It's just so big. It's like the size of a door. Right. So I got to cut it down when I need to use it. But I could never do that by shopping overseas. I could never just call and say, I could never and just solve it within minutes. Like, literally it was within minutes. They had solved the issue. So that's what I look for when I pick a vendor. And that's why for the last 10 years, I've been using Johnson Plastic Plus and other vendors that are here in the States that have that kind of reputation.
Yeah, I think, you know, everybody, money talks, right? So we all totally understand that. And especially in a business, understanding, like, you know, we want to save money, but to your point, sometimes it might save you money to spend a little more because you could solve a problem, like you said, within minutes, and time is money. So I think that's an excellent point. I am curious. So we talked a little bit about products and products that you use a lot. Do you have a favorite sheet material or product or project that you've made using products from Johnson Plastics Plus, whether it's Romark sheet material or a blank?
100%. And I talk about it all the time. I'm going to pull up the part number right now. You have no idea how much I love this product from Romark.
I just saw your face light up to talk about it. So I'm excited to see what it is.
It's so exciting. So I'm going to go here. I'm going to go to community. So I just did a post on it yesterday, actually. It's the Laser Max. It's by Laser Max, and it is the brushed silver and black 2-ply Romark Laser Max 1/16 inch with the adhesive backing. Like, that's how much I order it. I don't order like metric tons of it, but I have been ordering it for 8 years, and it is like, it lives in my shop. Like, it is like, it won't leave my shop, and I'll tell you why. So I just did a post on it on the YouTube channel. I posted a project that I did with this, how much I charged, what it was, what the name of the product is. It's the LM922334 quarter sheet, if you want to get real specific. The reason I love this product is because it's too hard to keep. First of all, I don't cut metal in my shop. I don't have a laser cutter that can cut custom steel plates or brass plates. Like, I just don't. Some people do, not many, but I don't. I don't have a stamping thing that cuts out material. And I get called for nameplates often, you know, and they want a nameplate for a trophy. They wanted a plaque for a wood award. They need a data plate for a piece of machinery, whatever it is. And they want it out of steel or brushed metal, whether it's gold or silver. Those are the two that they always, a brass or silver, they always ask for the same thing. And I found out really quickly early on that this product simulates a metal plate and can be easily cut and engraved with the CO2 laser. And I can cut it into any shape they could possibly ask for, any size. And I explained to them, this is a faux metal finish. It is not metal. It's a very industrial acrylic. And as far as anyone is concerned from a distance, they're going to think it's a metal plate. Until you get up really close and touch it, you really won't know. That's how much it looks like a metal plate. And once I tell them that, and they tell them the price and how much cheaper it is than an actual piece of custom metal plate, they're like, that sounds great. Go ahead.
Go
ahead and make me those. Right. And I have made tens of thousands of dollars over the last year on that one single product alone. So I would suggest to anyone listening to this that you get yourself some Laser Max brushed silver and black 2-ply and Laser Max brushed, I think it's brass or brushed gold with black engraving 2-ply with the adhesive backing, and just keep 2 or 3 of those sheets in your shop at all times, so you're ready to go next time someone asks for a custom nameplate or data plate, because they're just so, it's such a great product. There you go. How's that?
I love it. Laser Max is one of my favorite product lines from Romark, the manufacturer. Romark makes some great plastic. It makes me think of, so there's Laser Max, which is really cool. Like you said, there's all those different colors. Some that look like they have that brushed finish. And then they even have, it just made me think of one of my favorite product lines from Romark that I think sometimes kind of gets buried, but is really cool, is the Naturals by Romark, because they look like it's plastic, but it looks like wood, or it looks like stone and metal. Metal Graph is another one. So I think this is a really great point of the power of a CO2 laser and combining it with the right materials, because you can get those looks that people are trying to get with a fiber laser and metal or type of material like that, but it's really using plastic. So like you said, you can work faster, you can make more, and therefore pay your machine off quicker and then get to your profit quicker. So I'm so glad that you are loving Laser Max, because it has a special place in my heart too.
Yeah, it's a really great product. And they also have, I think it's called the Metal Graph, which is more designed outdoors. So it has, I think, a better UV resistant coating for like heavy duty outdoor use. So just make sure you pick the right one. You know, Laser Max works good outdoors too. But I did notice that, you know, over an extended period of years, it will start to fade. But with the Metal Graph, I don't believe that it has much more longevity. So just pick the right material for the project, you know?
Yeah. And I think that's a great point is, you know, on jpplus.com, you can purchase, we carry Romark and we carry their full line of plastics. And if you ever have questions about like what material works for what application, like pick up the phone and call us, because you know, some things work great for outdoors, like you said, some things work better for indoor, some things work better for, you know, a museum where people are going to be touching it and you don't want a fingerprint. So I think that's a great thing to consider, is picking the right material for the right project, similar to picking the right laser for your business. I do have a question about how you keep up and informed with technologies and trends within this industry that we're in. Is there anything that you like to do to keep up to date?
Definitely. I'm a big fan of YouTube. You know, I have to say, like, since I'm on YouTube as my kind of other kind of, I don't know, I guess it's a business now, but, you know, it's still not what I do full time, but I am on YouTube a lot and I source a lot of my information, from YouTube. It's kind of spoon fed to me because YouTube knows that I am into lasers. So anything new that comes out, they will kind of just say, hey, we saw this new piece of equipment, maybe you should watch this video. But, I do, you know, I do look at magazines. There's a few magazines out there that I really like that usually have some great articles in them. Sometimes they talk about emerging laser technology. There's some other YouTube laser channels that I like to follow, like Laser Everything. Alex is a good friend of mine, and he is really gets into the equipment side of things and the technology side of things. And I really enjoy that about what he does there. There's lots of good resources on YouTube, but that's, and then of course I get solicited every month by a lot of different manufacturers asking me to look at their equipment, maybe review their equipment. And it's just a very hot time for laser engravers right now. It's a it's very fascinating to me. And also it's entertaining to watch this grow, because you have to understand that 10 years ago, it was not like this. There was CO2 lasers and there was fiber lasers, and they were all very, very expensive. They were kind of the barrier to entry was kind of high. And as the barrier to entry for getting into this industry has been lowered and lowered and lowered, it's been fascinating to see all these different types of laser engraving business models pop up and different techniques and things. So YouTube. If you want to know how I keep my pulse on what's coming out, it's YouTube. It's like the new Encyclopedia Britannica. You know,
absolutely. It is. Yeah. So you kind of took me to my next question is, where do you see laser engraving going in the future? Do you think it's here to stay? Do you see it changing? What do you see happening in the next, 5 to 10 years?
I think in the next 5 to 10 years, there's going to be more combination machines. So like if you notice, I don't know if you noticed the F1 Ultra, just that the X tool, they're kind of a small business home base kind of laser factory, I would call it. It's the first one that I've really seen kind of go all in on having a laser that has multiple. Well, it's not the first, but I think we're going to see more combination systems where either you can change out the type of laser. It's like an all-in-one system. You can kind of change out the laser head depending on what you're engraving. I think there's going to be better and better software that's going to make it easier and easier for people to get into this space. So I see the software both with like Lightburn, X-Tool has their own software. I see lots of software improvements and tools being developed to make it easier for folks. I remember back when I started, there was no such thing as a camera in a laser. There was no cameras.
Yeah.
Like, and that's great. And it's cool that that's out there now. It has its purposes, but you have to understand, like, and anybody who was doing this, like I was 10 years ago, we don't have cameras. You just got to figure out how to register your stuff using different techniques and how to make sure it's aligned. There's no cheap camera. So those things, you see how things are improving, right? Lightburn came out a few years ago and it's like growing by leaps and bounds with all of its features, allowing people to control all these machines coming out in an easier, more powerful way. So combo machines, software improvements, and obviously, I don't know when the cost is going to stop dropping. Eventually it's going to have to stop somewhere.
Right.
You can only make a fiber laser for so cheap, but it has gone way down. I have to say that my $38,000 fiber laser, I bought that from LMT, Laser Marking Technologies Group out of Michigan. 10 years later, it's still my primary laser. Right here in my shop, I use it every day, every week, and it has not failed once. So it is a very powerful laser. I don't feel like I got overcharged at all in any way. And I can call LMT anytime, any day of the week, and they will pick up the phone and help me out if I have a problem. Once again, circling back to why I pick vendors, right?
Right. Yeah. And I think that's a great kind of reminder for people who are listening that it might seem like, I'm sure your gut kind of was like, oh my gosh, what am I doing when I'm spending $38,000 on something? But how many years later and it's still going, still producing, still making you money. So I think, investing in yourself and your business is scary, but worth it.
It is. And, getting into like leasing equipment, financing equipment can be super scary. And I totally understand that. But if you have the drive, you have the motivation. There's so many resources to get started in the engraving industry right now. It's so insane. There was none of this when I started. We just kind of had to figure it out and crawl through forums and maybe some little Facebook groups. There's so much more available for anyone looking to get into this industry now. It's really nice to see.
Yeah, we even have a couple options available for our customers who are thinking about purchasing any of the equipment that we carry at jpplus.com. And then we also have now financing available for, if you're just kind of getting started and you want to finance, even blanks and consumables is something that you can do through a firm with us. And my last question, and I think I know the answer to this because we just kind of talked about it, is as far as social media, what is your favorite social media platform to share your work and promote your businesses and why?
So definitely for sharing my work, might look. So we have to, I have two hats, right? I have the Sonoma laser engraving hat, and then I have this, you know, the laser engraving educator hat. So obviously for the laser engraving 911 educator, that platform is YouTube. It's been very successful for me. And that is where, if I want to share my knowledge and education, that is the best platform that I have found over maybe another platform like TikTok or some of the other sharing or Facebook even. I haven't even really started an official like Facebook group, but don't knock it, because I know other peers in this, in my industry here, who do really well on Facebook with their laser engraving community Facebook groups, and they're just have like, you know, tens of thousands of like members in their group, which is like amazing. Right. So for that hat, YouTube has been a great platform for me. For Sonoma laser engraving, I haven't really utilized YouTube that much to promote what I do here at Sonoma Laser Engraving, but I do, I have found success in Instagram. So Instagram for business, for my 9-to-5 business, I found that Instagram has been cool. Posting, that's where I usually post my work. If I'm really happy about something, a project I did, or I finished a project for someone and I'm really proud of it, I'll post a little reel on Instagram, like, look what I just made, you know, and that usually gets a little buzz, a little interest. I make sure my hashtags are local based, you know, so I can really cities around me and get, you know, hopefully we'll see it, you know. And then I think I need to visit Pinterest again as well. So I started using Pinterest early on, and I was getting some traffic from there, but I think I need to go and revisit that and start reposting some things on Pinterest as well. So Pinterest, Instagram, and Facebook, I guess, for promoting my business, and then everything else, YouTube.
So I have two final questions for you. So my first of the two final questions is, are there any just general final thoughts that you want to share with people in the laser community, people that might be listening to this, words of encouragement, advice, anything?
Well, I mean, I want to say that, like, there's so much knowledge that I have and that I've experienced through making mistakes over the last 10 years through trial and error. And, you know, you have to understand that when I make a video on a topic or whatever, I'm only giving you the cliff notes. So I YouTube, if I try to make an hour and a half video to really tell you how it is and really get into the nitty gritty of the things that I've learned, nobody's going to watch that. It's just too much to digest. Mm-hmm. But I try to give you the best parts of it on the channel. I do want to say that for anyone listening, if you do want any kind of private consulting with me, you can go to my website and you can buy a 1-hour session with me. And I'm happy to discuss any topic or question that you would have about the laser engraving business, for sure. And I can really get into a subject with you that I've been doing a lot of these lately. And every time I finish one, I usually get a really nice email about how valuable it was and how it really just helped clear all the smoke that they were trying to get through to get right to what they needed. So there's that. And then also, I can't stress enough, you said it yourself, time is money. I always say this in my videos. You can make some things and sell on Etsy with a very simple, slow laser. But if you're going to want to scale up and make a really, so there's making money, and then there's making a living, and then there's just killing it. Right. Then there's like, you're killing it, you know? So those are the levels. There's hobby level, making a living, getting by, and then there's killing it. So, and the way you're going to kill it in the laser engraving industry, by having top of the line machines, the fastest machines on the market, like the new Aeon Redline series, the Aeon Laser Redline series that just came out, or an Epilogue. Mm-hmm. Those machines are expensive, yes, but those machines are going to put you in a position to output so many jobs per year because they're so fast and powerful that that is how you're going to get ahead. There's no point in buying $1,750 diode lasers and having them all in a row in a giant workshop trying to do what one machine could do in a day. So time is money, folks. Don't forget it. If you have the opportunity and you want to get ahead, invest in fast, high quality machines. Yeah.
So my final question is, if people are listening,
I love it.
If somebody's listening and thinking, you know, man, I really would love to, you know, take an hour, learn from this guy, where can they find you? Where can they see your work? Where can we find you online?
Yeah, so best place to find me online is just sonomalaserengraving.com. That's S-O-N-O-M-A. And then you can all figure out how to spell laser engraving. And there is my website where it talks about my services. And in there, you can find a section for the consultation. There's a link in there where you can book that with me. I always encourage that people shoot me an email first if they're thinking about booking a consultation. One of the things that I don't do in consultation is a technical support. So I leave that to the manufacturer of the laser. What I'm offering is my experience growing your business, laser engraving techniques, places that you can go to source blanks, what I've found successful, things like that. But if you're having an issue with your machine, you're going to want to contact the manufacturer to solve that. I'm not a technical support guy. I am a laser engraving business consulting guy. That's what I like to do. And that's what I do best. So yeah, just go to the website, and once you get to the website, you can shoot me an email. You can, anything you want. Right now the website is currently under construction because we are starting to bring on some online products finally, which is something that's kind of new to me. Remember that my primary business model is people bring me things to engrave. I engrave mm-hmm. them, give them back. That is how I have operated for over 10 years now. Recently, I was like, okay, I'm going to start bringing in more blank items and I'm going to start selling across the nation. I'm going to see how that works. So I'm constantly making new listings now and just diving into that. I know people think that's strange because some people start their business that way and they don't mm-hmm. want to do what I do. They don't want to engrave other people's stuff. They just want to make a finished product and sell that, a personalized product. I'm the opposite, and I'm just now getting into doing personalized custom gifts that you can buy on my website. So if you see some blank categories and some things that aren't filled in there, just know that by the end of the year, that catalog will be full and we're going to give it our best.
Awesome. So I think this was really, really great to chat with you. And I think the biggest thing I've heard and the takeaway from our chat today is, you know, running a laser business is a journey and a winding road. And sounds like you ended up in some really great, beautiful places. So thank you so much for joining us. And we will see you around online.
Yeah. And thanks for having me, Jackie. Appreciate it.
You've been listening to the Pint Size Personalization Podcast with your host, Jackie Faith, brought to you by Johnson Plastics Plus. Please remember to like and subscribe to this podcast wherever you get your podcasts. And for more information on the thousands of customizable products we have available, visit jpplus.com.